Hello and welcome everyone to ACP's Blueprint Series. Today's webinar is about franchising and the Vetrepreneur program. I wanted to give a little background here. Veterans are at the heart an entrepreneurial group of Americans, I think. According to the U.S. Small Business Administration, veterans are 45% more likely to start their own small business. And one out of 10 small businesses in the U.S. are veteran-owned, which is quite a majority of small businesses based off our population. So that's around 2.4 million businesses. So there's definitely a need for some assistance here. And that's why I'd like to tease an up-and-coming program here at ACP that we're building as we speak to help entrepreneurs. So follow us on social media to read about the big announcement in the coming months. But today, we're going to explore the potential of franchising as a post-military career with our friends from Vetrepreneur. We're going to hear from U.S. Navy veteran Chris Hale. He's the CEO of Vetrepreneur. And then Amy is a U.S. Navy veteran and a thriving franchise owner herself. So she's going to shed some light on the journey from military service to successful franchise ownership. Vetrepreneur connects veterans with franchise opportunities and the resources and coaching available for aspiring franchisees. And they talk about things like the ideal timeline for starting this journey. So we're going to discuss why veterans and their spouses are uniquely suited for franchising, the benefits of starting a small business, and gain some personal insight from Amy on choosing and thriving in her franchise. So I just remind everybody that if you have any questions, put them in the chat. We'll get to them a little bit later in the broadcast. And this will remain on our LinkedIn and I'll be posted on our website. So if you have friends you want to share this with or you want to watch it again, please feel free to do that. So now let's introduce Chris and Amy. So let's start with Amy. Amy, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Hello. So I am, Rich said, a Navy veteran. I left the service in 2006 and kind of made the jump to the civilian world, which isn't as always as easy as we would like it to be. But we discovered Vetrepreneur about a year and a half ago, in a letter from the VA. So we decided that we had always wanted to own our own business. So my husband and I reached out to Chris to find out more about entrepreneurship through franchises. We both did not want to own a McDonald's or Chick-fil-A, but we wanted to kind of be something we could do together. That was really important to us. And we had very diverse backgrounds and Chris really helped us figure out what the best path to ownership was for us with our different backgrounds.
Great, thanks. Chris, tell everyone who you are.
Rich, thanks for having us. I first want to say thanks to ACP. You guys are a great organization, a great partner. Appreciate the work that you have done for so long in helping connect veterans to jobs and all kinds of opportunities. So great to be here. Thank you for having us. And thanks to Amy for joining us. Chris Hale, Navy veteran, spent 9 years on active duty in the P3 community, which is an anti-submarine warfare aircraft. I was self-loading baggage on one of those, a Navy flight officer. And then I got out of the Navy in 1999, 2000, worked for Procter & Gamble for a few years before founding the company that we have now. So we exist to connect the military community to civilian opportunity, and really excited today to talk about what that means from a franchising perspective. So again, thanks for having me.
Yeah, that's great. No, thanks. And as Chris mentioned, we work with a lot of different other veteran service organizations, and I think we all have a similar mission, or whoever we can help, whoever's the best person to help, we pass people back and forth. And we've been working with Chris and Victory for quite a while with GI Jobs and Vetrepreneur. So definitely been great. So I think first we're going to hear Chris going to kind of talk us through their Vetrepreneur franchise boot camp a little bit so we can understand what that's about, because this is a class that you want to go to if you're thinking about starting a franchise. So Chris, let's hear it.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is the way I like to start these off, right? This is one of my favorite things to do, and our coaches, one of their favorite things to do. And the reason is we get asked all the time from veterans who have been a part of a large organization. The U.S. military is really a big corporation if you think about it. And so when veterans leave the service, one of the things that they are oftentimes itching for is starting their own business. But usually the reasons they say that they can't do it is, I don't have any particular industry experience, nor do I have a great idea for a new product or service. And that is usually the number one thing that stops them from starting a business. And the great part about that whole thing is that franchising is the ideal answer to all of that, because it does not require you to have either of those two things. You will be taught everything that you need to know in franchising. So this is one of my absolute favorite things to do. When we talk about franchising, this is my NATOPS manual from 1995. NATOPS is the Naval Aviation Training and Operating Procedure Standardization. Really thick manual. This is basically the Bible for how we operate and maintain a P3 Orion, which is now a P8, and to make sure that we do that safely and effectively. And every veteran, regardless of what field you were in, if you were in involved in tanks or anti-air aircraft or whatever it was, submarines, other types of aircraft, missile batteries, whatever you did, you had checklists and you had ways about operating manuals for how to run that equipment and operate that machinery in a safe and effective way that accomplished the mission. And franchising is the same thing. Somebody else has written the blueprint, figured out the business, figured out all the ways to do it well, figured out the reasons why it won't work, and given you all the answers to the tests. And a franchise process and a franchise system is nothing more than taking this NATOPS manual and operating that, executing that plan. So we're all very, very good as veterans. We're very well trained and we're very good at executing a business plan and executing a plan. And that's what we do. And that's what franchising is all about. So it's a hybrid between working for somebody else and starting an entirely new business on its own. Some of the terms you'll hear, franchisee, is Amy, right? That's the person who licenses from the franchisor, which is the sort of the mothership, the creator of the franchise system, the rights to operate that business at a local level. Next slide. Some franchising facts. 1 in 7 businesses is a franchise, and 1 in 7 franchisees is a military veteran. So again, we're very much overrepresented in business ownership. And the reason is because we know how to operate and we know how to execute a plan. We know how to follow a system and a process and do that with a high degree of effectiveness. This does not require a ton of experimentation. You want to start your own business from scratch? That's what that's about. But if you want to take that operating manual and execute it, that's what franchising is all about. There will be about 2,500 veterans who will operate and open a franchise every year. So there's about 6 or 7 every day veterans that become franchise owners in the U.S. Next slide. Some of the advantages to franchising, we talked about them, right? It mitigates the risk. It doesn't eliminate the risk. You're still going to be investing in a business that you're going to operate, and business is not without risk, but it does mitigate a lot of the risks because somebody else has figured out really the best way to go about doing this. Next slide. What do you pay for that, right? You pay franchise fees or something that is paid one time upfront. Typically, those are going to be anywhere from maybe $40,000 to $60,000 upfront. And that gives you the rights to operate that business at a local level. It also gives you access to the administrative setup, the supply chain, the different vendors and different ways that you're going to plug into that business. The second fee that you'll pay is called royalties. Next slide. And those are fees that will be ongoing. So these are things that are typically levied on a percentage of your revenues. It's typically anywhere from maybe 5% to 10% of total revenues that you'll pay for the duration. So that pays for the ongoing support that you get at the franchisor level. Sometimes there might be ad fees and other things involved in that. By the way, I failed to mention on the franchise fees, almost every franchise system has discounts. Not everyone, but almost everyone has discounts for veterans. And veterans are really the only group, to my knowledge, that has any sort of discount involved in it. I think that speaks volumes for the way that the franchising industry views veterans. They very much want to attract veterans as franchise owners. they're not doing this out of the goodness of their heart or because it's the right thing to do or because they just love veterans, just because they served and they're thankful for their service. They're doing it because veterans are really good at running businesses that they are given the operating manual to. Next slide. A couple different operating models. You can do what's called an owner operator, and virtually every franchise system will permit that. That's when you're essentially going to quit your day job and you're going to go into that business full on, right? It's going to be your full time and you're really your only professional pursuit is owning and operating that business on a full time basis. The other option, I would say maybe 40 to 50% of franchise systems will permit what's called semi-absentee. So that's where you're going to typically take, you might keep your day job and you might hire someone, maybe it's someone you're in business with, it might be a spouse, it might be a child, it might be an employee that you hire to sort of run the day-to-day business. And you kind of take on some role in the business. Typically as a semi-absentee, you're gonna be putting anywhere in from, you know, maybe 10 or 15 hours a week to as much as 30 or 40, but typically it's not gonna be a full-time endeavor. And there's Amy. So the franchise disclosure document, the great thing about this document, although it can be a cure for insomnia, it's a very lengthy document, has a lot of detail in it. It is the Federal Trade Commission has made it really easy for you to do the due diligence and figure out everything that you need to know about that business. If you've bought a home before, you get a seller's disclosure. This is very similar to that. So when you buy a business, you want to make sure that you know everything about that business. So you can see the different items in here. Regardless of what franchise you get into, they will be have a very consistent format, and they'll have 23 different items. Probably the most interesting in here is the item 19, which is where you get to see the historical financial performance of that franchise system. But it's also going to cover in items 5, 6, and 7, some of the initial fees. It's going to cover the backgrounds of the founders. It's going to show you how many businesses, how many franchise outlets have opened and closed over a period of time. So there's just a wealth of information in this FDD. Where do you get it? You'll get this from the franchisor. They'll send this to you as part of their process. Some of the myths. You know, a lot of people come to us and they say, I love Chick-fil-A. Somebody mentioned Chick-fil-A, right? I love Chick-fil-A. I love the sandwiches, or I love McDonald's. I want to open up a McDonald's franchise. And it is absolutely the worst thing to do, because you need to make sure that you are oriented towards running that business, not just a lover of the product or service that the business produces. But a lot of people think it's all restaurants. That's natural. We all think of, you know, the places that we love to go eat as franchises, and a lot of them are. But there's a lot of great businesses in service. Amy has a home services / distributorship business that she'll talk about. Which is really successful. Listen, is it too expensive or too risky? A lot of these businesses that are home-based that don't require a big, significant real estate investment, sometimes you can get into these for between $100,000 and $200,000 all in cost. And you may have some liquid capital requirements for that and can finance the rest of it. So is it too risky? It's not risk-free, but like we talked about, it does mitigate. And you certainly don't need business experience or experience in the industry. Really, that franchise system is there to teach you all of that. We've broken it down into 10 steps. We work with a lot of folks who have been at what we call the franchise buffet for a really long time. And that's when you go and you Google franchising, and you're going to get hit with a lot of information from a lot of different people. You don't know what to believe, what not to believe. You're getting information at the wrong time. You don't have the perspective or the educational background to understand it. And so it's really important that we said, if we want to get veterans into franchising, we need to break this down into a system that's digestible, bite-sized chunks. So these are our 10 steps. Ironically, they cover about 10 weeks. We can, you know, sometimes that can be done in as short as 5 or 6 weeks. Sometimes it goes longer, 5 or 6 months, but typically about 10 weeks is about the process. And at the end of this process, our goal is to make sure that you can make a decision on whether or not franchising is right for you. And if so, which one is best? What we, not everybody that goes through the process becomes a franchise owner. That's okay. Our goal is to make sure that you get to a decision point. What we don't want is for people to be, you know, at the end of their career, looking back and saying, I woulda, shoulda, coulda, right? And because you haven't had a Sherpa or a guide that's going to guide you along the way and get you to a point where you can make an informed decision for yourself. So these are the steps. It starts with a franchise discovery meeting. It's step three, ultimately wrapping up about 10 weeks later with a discovery call, which is where you get to meet the staff and a whole bunch of stuff in between. I won't spend too much time on this, but validation, which is step eight, one of my favorite parts. That's when you get to talk with other franchise owners that are in the system. What do you like about it? What are the challenges? How does the franchisor help you overcome some of those challenges? And that, I think, is really one of the more valuable parts. Next slide. How do you fund it? A lot of different ways is the short answer. A slightly longer answer is SBA loans are very popular. If you are a homeowner, you can do a home equity line of credit. If you have a retirement account, you can either do a loan from a 401k, or you can convert that over and invest in your own business, called a rollover for business startup. The other thing oftentimes people forget about is friends and family. If you've got parents or, you know, a rich uncle or something like that that can give you a loan, or if you're going to get an inheritance from your parents anyway, I wasn't that fortunate, but if you are, oftentimes they can give you that sooner so they can get you on your way to starting your business. So there's a lot of different ways that you can fund these. Next slide. And then, our full service franchise coaching. It's free. Ultimately, if you're interested, you can hit that QR code. We'd be happy to help you. Our staff consists of former Chick-fil-A operators, former franchise owners. We've got a great staff. We've got six coaches on staff that are here to help. And, like I said, we believe that it's really helpful to go through this with the perspective of someone that's going to get you to a decision point and ultimately whether or not you should be a franchise owner. And I think this is part of our team. We've got folks that we will introduce to you along the way, some folks that reside within our own organization, and there will be some outside partners, loan providers. If you want to have lawyers review your legal documents, your franchise agreement, we can refer you to partners that we work with that can do that sort of thing. Credit repair specialists we've worked with in the past, accountants that can form your LLC and do some of the administrative thing of setting up your chart of accounts and things like that. So we've got a lot of partners that we can plug you into. And the goal here is really to fast track you to get to a decision point. And if you decide to open that business, make sure that we get you off on the right foot.
That's great, Chris. Yeah. Could you tell me about is this a something that that people can sign up for at any time, or do you have cohorts?
Yeah, really good question. They can sign up for it at any time. We do a franchise workshop, which is just a little slightly longer version of what we're talking about here. But they can sign up for this at any time, and then we will connect them with a franchise coach, and that they'll be allowed to set up that initial discovery call with the coach. It's about an hour long, and that's where they'll go into their background and so forth. And that's really where the process starts.
Great. So if anybody has any questions, don't forget to throw them in the chat. So Amy, let's hear a little bit about your journey. Chris made it sound like earlier on that you had a lot of decisions to make and maybe were a little bit difficult in your journey. So tell me a little bit about that.
Putting words in my mouth, Rich. You're going to get me in trouble.
Sorry, I've met me. I am a little difficult. So my husband and I both had really, I would say we had great careers. Neither of us were displeased in our careers. We were happy. So we were a little bit different in what we were looking for. We wanted to do something together as a team, and we come from very different backgrounds. I'm the sailor that married the farmer, which usually it doesn't work out that way. But my husband is an engineer and I'm a project manager. And so those also don't work out really well to be teammates either. So we had some things to overcome as far as what we wanted to do. My husband wanted to be able to get into the details of something. He was an engineer for 20 years and loves the details and how things work. And I tend to be a little bit more oriented towards projects and making sure we get done on that deadline. And Chris really helped walk us through that. And we found that what we thought we were going to do, completely different. I thought I would go into the project side of it and be like, all right, we can do this. And then I got into home improvement and figured out these people do not march the timelines in the way that I think they should. So we switched a little bit, and the engineer does that part, and I do the selling where it's, oh, it's pretty, this looks great. And then I kind of pitch it to the engineer, and he makes everything work great. But we kind of found it by accident, or accidentally, however that's correct in English. I was sitting at this desk, and was leafing through the VA newsletter and saw the article, and I was like, well, you know, hadn't really thought about it, and looked over it, read it. And then it took us probably, I don't know, 3 full months, because I think I read the article in December, reached out, and I think we signed officially in March. So we took a little longer, but not much. But we wanted to know what we were getting into. My husband had been in business before with his brother on a farm, which is completely different, but that's kind of from the ground up, what Chris talked about. If you have no playbook, no nothing, you just kind of go out there and do what your family has done for a long time. And we really liked all of the support. I wanted somebody that was going to give me training. Chris held up his manual. Mine took a little bit more. So I come from admin. So we had the Milpers man that took the entire office to fill up that book. But I wanted something that had a lot of rules and understanding of what everything was going to be required. And I didn't want there to be a lot of gray area, whereas my farmer husband was like, I need the gray to play in. So Chris really had to bridge that gap for us. So that would be why we were a little bit probably more difficult than some, but it really worked well for me. He did it on our timeline. We didn't have to lose any sleep over when we were going to tell our boss, what we were going to tell our boss. So we made sure everything was set up and ready to go. I actually was planning a multi-million dollar project for my company at the same time Chris was helping me get started. So it all kind of played into being able to do all of that. And then I was able to give my company plenty of advance notice and work with the franchise system to say, okay, this is our timeline. And I think we officially started June 1st. So it took us even just a little bit longer to get started because we wanted to make sure that everything where we were coming from was set and ready to go. Other than that, I don't know. I think it was probably the best decision we ever made.
And so I guess I want to back up a little bit and just kind of understand both between Chris and Amy, but I'll start with Amy. How did you decide what franchise that you were going to partake in? Because there seems to be a lot of different ones out there, and I don't even know the extent of it, but I know there's more than, you know, restaurants and such.
So that's where Chris really helped us, because we really didn't know other than the Chick-fil-A, the McDonald's. We had no idea. We wanted to make sure it was something we could do together. And so he really kind of led us down the path. Owner-operator was where we were at. We did not want to be semi-present. And we wanted something that would support our entire family, because both of us wanted to leave corporate together. So Chris helped us navigate which one was going to fit ours, and the training aspect and the support aspect for Floor Coverings International is kind of what really sealed the deal for us. I left my job June 1st and we didn't open until July 31st. I went through 2 solid months of training, just learning everything I needed to know before they even put me out on the streets. And that really said that was going to be the support system we wanted. And it has been to this day, the support that we needed and that we continue to need.
That's great. So Chris, do you have like just a big menu, or how do you do it?
Yeah. Really good question. I'll say that we look at franchise owners. First of all, I want to make one comment if I could, Rich, go back to something Amy said, is her and Rex are not the same person. And there are really 3 roles that you've got in a franchise. Really, your 3 primary roles are take care of your people, the employees, take care of your customers, and be the representative of your organization to, you know, to customers and the community at large. And then the third is to manage the resources, which is really analytical, right? And each of the, you know, very few people constitute all 3 of those qualities at a high level. And so it's really valuable when you see a married couple or, you know, a partner or whatever that come to the table with different qualities, because they can cover all those bases between the two of them. And so that's a really, really powerful thing. You don't have to have your spouse involved in the business, but I think if it fits and it works and you're able to do it, even if it's, you know, one spouse keeps their job and the other one does it full time, it can be a very, very powerful thing. And Amy and Rex just complement each other very well in terms of their skills. In terms of the matching, it really, we look at it, there's really two primary things. One, we want to know, what do you want to get out of this business? That's the primary question. Secondly, we want to know, what are your fears? And then from there, the matching really happens in four areas. Two of them are pretty analytical. We want to look at geographically what's available in your area based on territories. Secondly, what are you financially qualified to, you know, because it runs the gamut from $100,000 to multiple millions of dollars. And so based on what your financial qualifications are and how much you want to invest in the business will determine that. So those are kind of analytical. The other two are less, there's some analysis involved in it and there's some just experience involved in it. And those are, one of those is lifestyle. So what lifestyle do you have now? And what lifestyle are you seeking in your business? And then the last one is skills and interest. Where are the specific skills and interests that you've got, and how do those match up with the different types of businesses out there? We worked with about 600 different franchises, and we break those down into about 15 different industries. So we're literally like about 40 deep on average in every industry. So breaking that down, ultimately, you know, what we'll do after a discovery call is introduce maybe 10 to 15 different businesses to the franchise, prospective franchisee. And then from that, we'll have a discussion on what they like specifically about that, what they don't like, and ultimately get that down to typically one or two, at most three, and then start the due diligence process on those. So that's generally how it works.
That makes sense. And so, yeah, it sounds like there's a lot of different franchises. I would never even thought there were so many of them. So when you're doing this matching, it sounds like Amy mentioned, like her and her husband both wanted to kind of, they wanted to be their sole source of income and obviously provide for their family. So is that something you all take into consideration as well? Like do you have that type of information, like goals of profits for each type of franchise or something like that?
Yeah, so franchising is very highly regulated by the Federal Trade Commission. So when they talk about earnings, those earnings can only come from two. One is the FDD. That's one of the source for where you can get earnings information. And the second source is from other franchise owners in the system. You can ask them about, you know, hey, how much business did you do in your first year? What were your profits last year? They don't have they don't have to disclose that to you, but oftentimes through the validation process, they will, because they know that they were in that situation at one point too. So it's very regulated in terms of the earnings information that you're allowed to talk about. FDD and other franchise owners are really the two sources for that. But yeah, for sure. And I'll say one thing too, Rich, where veterans have a distinct advantage over non-veterans, you know, you're a military retiree. You're a great example. Veterans have typically access to a lot of passive income that most non-veterans don't have. And that can be in the form of military retirement pension. It can be in the form of VA disability compensation. Even if you don't get VA disability compensation, but you have healthcare benefits, a lot of people are afraid to quit their jobs because they'll lose their healthcare. But if you've got that through the VA, that provides an economic sort of passive income or a way to cover some expenses that gets you over that hurdle of period of time between when you sort of quit your day job and when you can really kind of, your business really generates enough income to replace and then ultimately hopefully exceed the income that you had in the past. So veterans are really well insulated in a lot of ways for that.
That's great. I was reading some articles to prepare for this. And there was one that lists five kind of barriers. And so I was going to read them out and see, Amy, if you have run into any of these barriers that you can discuss a little bit more. And then maybe Chris, you can maybe help with some of the fixing, you know, maybe again, dispelling some of it. But, and some of this was in your presentation, but I think it's interesting to think of them as barriers or kind of probably what makes people anxious about not wanting to do a franchise by themselves. But one is financial barriers. Two is social and human capital barriers, meaning kind of employees. Three is regulation and policy barriers. Four is cultural and knowledge barriers. And the fifth one is marketing barriers. So Amy, did you have any of these barriers? And if so, how did you overcome them?
So the first two, not really. Our family was very, very supportive. And so we took a business loan out through a banker that my husband's family's been doing business with for like the last 50 years. So that one wasn't a difficult hurdle for us to overcome, but I know a lot of people do have that hurdle. And socially, everyone was really supportive of what we were doing. My boss was a little bit more surprised than my husband's boss was, but they still were very supportive, and I still talk to my old boss still to this day. As far as
I was just gonna follow up on that one. The one that mentioned human capital. So do you have employees? Because I guess this is another consideration, right, Chris, that you probably might have, right? Is do you want to have employees or how many or something like that? So do you have employees, Amy?
We do have employees. We have two full-time and one part-time. So we have a full-time office manager and a full-time salesman. And then my little brother actually decided to work for us part-time. So he sales for us part-time. And that wasn't a huge hurdle for us either, because I think, as Chris mentioned, we brought some different aspects to the table. And while I am admittedly very biased, Rex is an excellent people manager. So he does a really good job of managing the people, and I just kind of get to sit over here and nod. So that was something that we did take into consideration, but that's something he has always been very passionate about, is leading people. So that one wasn't it was difficult to hire though. So we got help from the franchise system to actually hire and used a recruiter when we hired our salesman. And that was one of the benefits that we found being within a franchise, is we were able to kind of bounce off of other people what it was we were specifically looking for and what were our must-have traits, because nobody's going to come in with absolutely everything. To Chris's point earlier, we all can't fill every role. So being able to talk to other franchise owners about what is it that we really need in an office manager or a salesman helped us bring on what we felt was the right candidate. And we still have both of our original hires. We have not replaced either role at this point. And then as far as
there was a lot regulation and policy barriers. So did you have any concerns about like navigating taxes and legal fees and federal regulations, inspections, and all that stuff?
So regulations was probably the one. So marketing was the other one. Those are probably the two we struggle with the most. The franchise system definitely attempts to help, but as we're nationwide, it's hard to know the regulations in each individual place. I think somebody asked about rules for New York versus somebody else. All of the rules are different. So that would be the only place that I wouldn't say knocks it completely out of the park. We really needed to find some local people to help us, because there's not another franchisee in Kansas really. So there wasn't somebody for us to ask about Kansas tax law or Kansas rules. We kind of had to navigate that through local people. But what we found was they got us started, and then we were able to kind of move over into the local areas. And we're kind of balancing the two right now, trying to figure out some of the marketing is a little different here than it is in Cleveland or Pittsburgh or wherever else. And so just navigating that and still having that support, but still needing to find our own, has probably been the most challenging of those last two, the regulations and marketing, because everybody's different.
Yeah. So Chris, how does your program kind of talk through some of these things? Like, we'll start off, I'll just hit them one by one. You can give us a little bit. The financial barriers, you mentioned some of it as some suggestions. Do you also have access to or recommendations to areas that veterans or spouses might be able to find additional funding?
Yeah, I mean, I would tell you, Rich, the vast majority of business are going to be funded through those things I mentioned: SBA loan, home equity line of credit, 401k loan, 401k rollover, or just self-funding or family funds, right? I would say probably the vast majority are coming through those sorts of programs. In fact, virtually all of it is going to come through one of those vehicles. But it provides you a lot of flexibility. And sometimes you can do those things in combination. I think the biggest thing that we see is people understanding that there's going to be some working capital requirements that will go into your calculation in terms of how much money you need. And that working capital is required because there's going to be a point in time where you got to hire employees. You might have to buy some equipment or some vehicles or inventory or whatever before you start generating revenues. And so it's important to know what those numbers look like. And this is why I said, like, if you've got passive income, it's certainly not required. You may have some, you know, some savings that you can put into that, or you can also take a loan out for some of the working capital requirement. But it's having some sort of passive income. Not everybody has it, but a lot of veterans have it way more frequently than non-veterans. And it's just really powerful. Even something that seemingly trivial as healthcare insurance, that prevents a lot of people from making the jump because they're like, how am I going to replace that? If you got VA healthcare insurance, it's a big thing. So
yeah,
that's on the funding side.
So Amy, if you don't mind me asking, and if you don't want to answer, that's fine. But at what point did you start feeling comfortable as far as financially before you were, you know, not going to jump off the roof or something?
So we had a lot of savings. So we've been living off savings and taking. So we had some cash accounts for investments. And so we had kind of what Chris was talking about, passive income. I get VA disability as well. So we have that. I think this going into knowing what it was going to take really helped us to never really have that heart attack of, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? So we have not really hit that point of, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? Because we were aware of the risks going in and aware of what we needed to do. So we set that all up before we actually turned in notice and quit our jobs. So okay. We make sure we had all that.
That's really good recommendation to kind of set that stuff up and have those passive income like Chris was mentioning. Chris, is there any kind of statistics or rule of thumb that you all use that kind of like expect it to take X number of months or years before you're making money or something like that? I've heard this in the past, not scientifically, but you know, if you're running a restaurant, it takes 2 years before you really can start making money or something like that.
Yeah, it's a great question, Rich. Unfortunately, the answer is it depends. Yeah. It really does. And I know you hate to hear that, but I mean, there are some businesses where it may take you a couple of years until you replace the income, you know, that maybe you had if you quit your job to start the business. There are some businesses that may give you a return on that investment much sooner. So I would say it's important for the short term to make sure that you're managing your cash properly and you know what that looks like. And there is a lot of great resources, right? The franchise disclosure document, the item 19, and also talking to other business owners and talking to the franchisor. There's a lot of resources that you can get to come up with a pretty good estimate for your pro forma income statement so that you can kind of see how you can manage that cash. The other thing I want to mention, in terms of the income streams over time, they really kind of fall in when we talk about ROI, because obviously people want this to be something they enjoy and a good lifestyle and well suited for it. But at the end of the day, you're investing money. You want to get a return on that investment. So ROI is always a consideration. That return, the R in ROI, really takes four forms. People think naturally, okay, if I own the business and the business generates this much in profits on an annual basis, okay, that's obviously one of them. And that's usually one of the bigger chunks of it. But you may pay yourself a salary. That's the second part of it. The third one, which a lot of people forget about, is there's tax advantages. So if you have whatever vehicles, a home, if you're using a portion of your home to store inventory, or you have a home office as part of to run the business, you can write off a portion of an expense that you're already incurring anyway, in your mortgage and your property insurance and taxes and utilities. You can write off a portion of that. And you don't pay taxes on that. So it's not an extra expense. It's the same expense you would have had, but you're going to save money in the form of income because you're going to pay fewer taxes. So that oftentimes applies to a home, a vehicle, and sometimes a few other things. And then the last one, which is oftentimes the biggest chunk, is when you go to sell that business. These businesses are typically going to sell for some multiple of the annual earnings. And so, if you grow this business from nothing to something that's generating income, take that annual income, multiply it by, you know, generally anywhere from 2 to 3 to 4 times annual income. And that's generally going to be a vicinity of where that market value is. And that's going to be taxed at capital gains. So when we talk about ROI, it's really four parts of that.
That's good. I think for sure, if I was to start a franchise, I definitely would seek out the Vetrepreneur program to help walk through this. There's a lot of questions that I have, but it sounds like you all have thought through a lot of this. And if Amy is any indication of success, you do a pretty good job at it. So I definitely would encourage people to check it out. We have a few questions in the chat I wanted to get to, and if anybody else has any questions, go ahead, throw them in there. But so Eric, he wrote, I'm going to put it up on the screen because I'm not sure if this, so he said he scanned the QR code, he saw a disclaimer. Is that because of New York State, or is that something else, or do you know what I'm talking about there?
Yeah, New York and Washington State have different franchise laws. So if you are in New York or Washington, there's just a different path that we have to take for coaching, and we'll refer you to folks who operate in those two states. That's okay. All.
Yep. That makes sense. And Eric, again, good question though. Is an LLC required for a franchisee?
Yeah, you will sign a franchise agreement, and you will typically create some sort of legal entity. Oftentimes it is an LLC. I think Amy and Rex formed an LLC. It can be a corporation as well, or a partnership. And a corporation can either be an S corporation, a subchapter S, or a C corporation. But yeah, you will form a business entity. Very easy to do. A lot of people get really worried. How do I do that? It's just an administrative thing that almost any accountant or lawyer can do. You can actually do it on your own as well. But you form that business entity, in this case, an LLC, and the franchise agreement will be an agreement between the franchisor and your LLC. That's the way it works. And you do that so that you are insulated personally against liability that the business may incur.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. And I've always understood that you do that in order to, you know, prevent someone from suing your family or taking your house away necessarily if something was to go wrong with the business. But hopefully nothing like that happened. So I'm not sure if we answered this question or not, but at the time, Brendan asked, can we talk a little bit more about the variety of other franchises? I know that, again, the initial thought is, oh, we're thinking restaurants. Amy, you said yours is it carpet or more than home?
So we have a Floor Coverings International franchise, which is carpet, home improvement, hardwood floors. If you walk on it, we sell it. So we do the sales and installation of everybody from Shaw to Mohawk, so all of the major brands. And so that was something that we were really excited for because I believe we're the sixth largest. The franchise system is the sixth largest buyer of flooring now. So we compete with the big stores as far as pricing, but we're still a small mom and pop shop. And so you get the best of both worlds.
Nice. Chris, I think that's probably biggest curiosity for people is like, is there a place they can go to look for different types of franchise or do some research before they get started?
Yeah, you can. Like I said, you can Google, you're going to get all kinds of information. I would tell you that we kind of break it down into, and we love to recommend primarily what we call franchises that are within industries that have really strong economic tailwinds. So I'll throw out a couple examples. Amy's in one of those. Home services is something that people are, you know, it used to be on the weekends, people did all kind of home improvement projects on their own, right? To include, you know, laying their own floors or doing at least part of that work. As a society, we've changed a lot in the last 5, 10, 20 years. We don't do that kind of stuff. We outsource a lot more stuff around the house. And Amy's business is a perfect example of somebody comes in, brings you all the samples, takes all the measurements, schedules the subcontractors for, you know, coming in and performing that work, and then follows up to make sure it was done properly. It's full service. And so home services, we're going to do more of that. We're not doing less of that. We're not going doing more Diddy. We're going to do more outsourcing specialized things, not less of that in the future. And Americans are wealthier than we've ever been in previous generations. Another one is senior care. Biggest generation is baby boomers. They have lots of money, and they are, you know, from age 60 to 80. They want to remain independent. They want to remain in their home. So senior care just has, there's a ton of business in senior care. Another real strong one is business to business, helping other business, performing services for other businesses that are out there. So we love those. There's lifestyle businesses, right? I would say that like restaurants, kind of like a lifestyle. If we've got somebody who says, I just love being around a kitchen. I love the heat of the kitchen. I love just being around my customers all the time. And it's just, I don't care about the ROI as much. And I really want to be in that kind of a lifestyle. That kids franchises, things like daycare, pets, right? That's another one that we sort of consider. Those are more lifestyle businesses. Not to say that there is not an ROI there. There is, but I would say the stuff that has really strong economic tailwinds in sectors that have a lot of growth prospects is where we generally like to recommend more frequently.
All right, and that makes sense. And so I think this goes right along with it. Todd was saying, you know, if I'm interested, should I research myself or just kind of get in touch with you all, because he's not really sure where to start. And I think there's a lot of people probably feel the same way.
Yeah, I honestly, I would say that the less research you do, probably the better off, because there's no, you know, myths that you may have been exposed to that we have to debunk. Because there's a lot of misinformation out there when you go to the franchise buffet. You know, there's good information too, right? But I would say that all you need to know will run you through the process. It will be condensed, and there's work. And Amy, I think, will tell you, you have homework. Like you have to research these things, and you have to watch these videos, and you have to read the FDD, and you have to come back with different, you know, having done your homework with the next call. You'll have calls with your coach typically every 1 to 2 weeks. You're going to have calls with franchisors where you're expected to read stuff. So there's a lot of research that's going to happen in that condensed period of time. It's going to be several hours a week to get through that process, but we'll get you through it. We'll expose you to all the perspectives we think that are important to make that decision. And at the end of it, it's your decision. We're here to inform that decision and help you make it.
That's great. And I think on that note, we'll go ahead and start closing it up. But my opinion is, talk to Chris and the team at Vetrepreneur to figure this out. I think that seems like, Amy, I think that was a good choice of yours. And it seems like they are well suited to help people figure out what they want to do and if they want to do this. So, Chris, thanks for this and your organization for recognizing the need and really taking it to a level where you make it almost easy for people to decide. So thank you for that. And Amy, thank you so much for sharing your background and your experiences. It's definitely great to hear from someone, one that's been through the process with Chris's team, but also you know, is out there doing it themselves. So thank you both for being here. We really appreciate it. I think we all learned a lot. And if anyone has any more questions, you know, go ahead and keep putting them in the chat and we can always push them over. But I think probably step number one is to reach out to the Vetrepreneur team and see if you can get in one of their classes or meet with one of their coaches. So thanks again, everybody. Have a great day. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Rich. Good to see you, Amy.